Boy, that's great. I tell you what, that'd make me want to preach, amen? It's good to be here tonight. I hope you have come ready for a study and Bible study tonight. We've already had a great message tonight. I appreciate you, Brother Jason. That was great preaching tonight, good teaching. I appreciate it. How many's glad you're saved? Amen. Hey, how many's glad you're not in jail? Amen. Not in the hospital? Amen. I want to welcome everybody. I want to welcome those that are listening by the way of live stream. I'll be using, you live stream folks, listen to me. I'll be using a lot of charts tonight and a lot of visual aids. You may not be able to see them all, but if you'd like to get them, just call here at the church, call Cindy and ask her for the handout. We can send them to you, and we'll be glad to do that. I'm glad for live stream for people that are sick and shut in. Amen. Now, if folk don't come just because they lazy, I'm not going to say it. Rich, you say it. Maybe a live stream ought to go down tonight or something. We ought to want to be at this. Something about being here together. And if you're ever off church for a long time and all you have was live stream, you get tired of it pretty quick, okay? But I'm glad for it. It is good. And it's helpful. Thank God for that. You got your Bibles open? Turn to one of the most remarkable passages of Scripture concerning prophecy in all the Word of God. And I'm going to read some verses, and then I'm going to go over a couple charts. I may get back to the outline. I've got so much to say in the next couple weeks. This is one of the most important Bible passages on prophecy and all the Word of God, especially from Daniel 7 all the way through 12. Now, if you have not been here on Wednesday nights, let me give you a way you can catch up. And Allison, you help me here. They can go to sermonaudio.com and put in John D. Smith, and you can go there, and my messages are there. Just find the book of Daniel. Go to YouTube, Tate Valley Baptist Church on YouTube. I think you can find them there. And there may be some on Facebook Live. I'm not sure. Go on our Facebook page, and you can get them that way. That way you can catch up with us, and it'll be helpful to you. Got your Bibles? Amen? Let's read a few passages of Scripture in chapter 7. Let me ask you a question. My sermon is, the first part's a question, and then the last two things I'm going to say are exclamation points. Number one, here's the question. Is anybody or anyone really in control? How many of y'all agree with me? It seems like our world is spiraling out of control. Come on, help me. You know, I'm grieved at what I see in this world, but I want all y'all to know we're getting close to the Jesus coming. Amen. We're getting real close. I hope you're ready to go. We're getting real close to Jesus coming, and I want you to know that we're real, real close. It's kind of sad. Our president is over there trying to deal with nuclear weapons, and then we got a bunch of yahoos in Congress trying to roast people. He's on one side of the world. They're on another side of the world, and it's all confusing, but I want all y'all to know some. Get a grip on this. God has everything in control. If you ask, is anybody really in control? And I'm going to answer you with an explanation point. Yes. His name's God. Amen. Amen. He's sovereign. Amen. Let's look at the passage. Then I'll allude to some charts, and then we'll try to give you as much as I can get in one lesson. The Bible said in the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head, upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea. Now notice this. And four great beasts come up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it, between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh. Are y'all still with me? Amen. After this, I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. And after this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast. And boy, you might want to note that. That's a great passage. I want you to kind of note that verse. After this, I saw in the night vision, behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. And it had 10 horns. Note that. And I considered the horns. And behold, now notice now, look at me, it had 10 horns. Now notice, I considered them, and behold, there came up among them another little horn. Y'all with me? Stay with me. Before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots, behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. Woo. Y'all still there? I beheld till the thrones were cast down. Now notice this statement. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit. I've read a lot of commentaries, and there's a lot of people doing it wrong. They're wrong if they say this. They say that's Jesus. That is not Jesus. And I'll prove that in a little bit. And you'll see it yourself. Some of you are going to smile in a moment. Now, notice this. Are y'all still with me? I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days just said, whose garments was as white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands and thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. And the judgment was set, and the books were open. Now stay with me. I beheld then because of the voice of the great words with the horn spake. I beheld even till the beast was slain and his body destroyed and given to the burning flame. As concerning the rest of the beast, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. Now notice verse 13. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like what? Somebody say it. One like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. How many of y'all remember, how many can quote Acts 1:11? Anybody? Chad, can you? Can you read it? Well, read it. Make sure it's the right one, okay? If I got the wrong reference. Is it Acts 1:11 I'm wanting to read? Yeah, stand up, Chad, with your preacher's voice.
Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
Amen.
He went up in the clouds, and one day at his second advent, we'll come back in the clouds. Amen. Now notice this. And came to the what? Lois? To the Ancient of Days. How many of y'all agree with me? The Son of Man and the Ancient of Days are not the same person. Y'all with me? You already learned something. And they brought him near before me. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Now, I have an outline for you tonight, and I'll get to it in a moment, maybe, maybe not. Considering all the material I've got tonight, I may not. But let's do two or three things. Will you get your charts out? First of all, I want you to get your charts out and get the chart correlation of dreams and visions. Go there with me. I'm going to get several charts out tonight, or at least three, but I want to give you these first. Correlation of dreams and visions. I want everyone to listen carefully. How many of you believe God is in control again? Do you know in Daniel 2 and Daniel 7, God gives history from the beginning all the way to the end? When the Antichrist comes, the church is raptured and the Antichrist has come, the 7 years of tribulation, the reign of the 10 toes, he gives history all the way to then, to when Jesus comes back as that stone cut out of the mountain, and then that mountain is formed, the millennial kingdom. Somebody said, I ain't never heard of that in my life. You're going to hear a lot of it in the next few weeks. And notice this now. In Daniel 2, remember when we studied, there was a head of fine gold. Class, who was the head of gold? Somebody tell me. Babylon. Who was the chest and the arms of silver? Media Persia. Who was the belly and thighs of bronze? Greece. Who was the legs of iron, feet of iron and clay?
Rome.
Who was the stone that becomes a great mountain? Come on now, don't die on me. Jesus. Now, go to this chart. Look here, look up at me. Go to this chart for a moment. The seven world empires. Now, look at the, before I go to this chart, look at the beast of chapter 7. I just read them to you, didn't I? Notice the head of fine gold and the lion with eagle wings. Write down in your margin there, Babylon. Write it down, Babylon. The chest and arms of silver. Write down, Media Persia. The bear, Media Persia. The belly and thighs of bronze is Greece. The leper with four wings and four heads is the Grecian Empire under Alexander the Great, and then distributed to four of his generals, and we'll get into that in our notes next week. And notice the legs of iron and feet of iron and clay, and then notice the incomparable beast with 10 horns and a little horn. And the same chapter, are y'all looking at this? The stone that becomes a mountain, that's Christ. The Messiah, the Son of God, man, and the saints receive the kingdom. Same vision, Chad. Now, in this chapter, we're in Animal House. Some of y'all get that in a minute. Now let's look at this chart. Are y'all with me? If you get puzzled, you got it? Thank you. Just look at it quickly. I'm not going to stay there long. Notice Daniel 2. It's sitting right there, right before you. The head of gold, Babylon. The breastplate of silver, Media Persia. The belly and thigh of brass, Greece. The legs of iron, Rome, divided in two. And then them 10 toes, which were of iron and clay. And the 10 toes is the last kingdom before Christ establishes his kingdom. Are y'all all with me? Can I tell you, the 10 toes of Daniel 2 and the 10 horns of Daniel 7 are the same. There's only one, let me ask you, class, there's one further revelation in Daniel 7 that was not in Daniel 2. And the first person that can tell me what it is, tell me. The little horn. So what we got to know now, Rich, who is the little horn? I know who the little horn is. The little horn is the Antichrist. Hello? The little horn that comes from the revised Roman Empire is the Antichrist. Are y'all with me? I'm going somewhere. I'm trying to make this clear. And if it doesn't get real clear in you and you're burning with a question, you can get one. But I'd like for you to let me get through this. Now look, go back to your seven world empires and notice that head of gold and look at the lion with the eagle's wings. Same, talk about the same group, talking about Babylon. Then the bear and the breastplate of silver, let's talk about Media Persia. I will later tell you who those three ribs are in the mouth of the bear. And then Greece, led by Alexander the Great, the four heads was Egypt, Assyria, Turkey, and Greece. And he overtook, that man conquered the whole world. But let me give you a little spiritual something here, application. He conquered the whole world, but couldn't conquer himself. Died a drunk, and died at the age of 32 years old, and conquered the whole world. Y'all all with me? Stay with me. Now, stay with the chart for one more moment. Now, here's where Bible students get off, and I want to help you. Now, where is the little horn coming from, Lois? It's coming from those 10 horns from that last ravenous beast, which is the Roman Empire, right? But if you read Daniel 8, look at your pretty chart. If you look at Daniel 8, Chad, there's another little horn. Oh, Rich, I've been asked 1,000 times this question. Is that little horn in Daniel 8 the same as the little horn in Daniel 7? Look at me. No. You said, how you know it's not? Well, it's easy. One's coming from the Roman Empire, and the other one's coming from the Grecian Empire. One of them was the Antichrist, and I can name the other one to you, and I know his name. And he reigned about 165 B.C. His name was Antiochus Epiphanes. I think I'm close. And he was a picture of the Antichrist. You know what that guy done? That guy, he was a forerunner of the Antichrist. Was not the Antichrist, but was a picture of the Antichrist. He went into the temple and desecrated the temple. That's why some people have their beliefs wrong. And they say Daniel's not prophecy, right, Chad? They said because they say that little horn in Daniel 7 and Daniel 8 is the same, and it's Antiochus Epiphanes. No, that's not right. One of them comes from Greece, and one of them comes from Rome. One of them has already come, and the other ain't come yet. But his spirit's here already. Whew. Y'all learn anything yet? Now, let me do one more thing. go to the timeline now. This is important. Then I'm going to give you some closing remarks the last 15 minutes. Then we'll get into the outline of the chapter next week. Get this out. How many's got this? The timeline of Daniel 2 and 8. And I want you to know something. Just look at it. It shows world history all the way through Rome and the 10 toes. And notice Messiah. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but we're going to study the 70 weeks of Daniel, and Messiah's going to get cut off at the end of the 69 weeks. And I want y'all to know there's a gap between the 69th week and the 70th week, because the 70th week of Daniel is the tribulation period. And you said, I don't understand all that. You will when I get to it, and I'll explain it thoroughly then. But I want you to notice something. The 70th week of Daniel is going to be the tribulation period, and the tribulation period will not be for the church. The tribulation period will be for the Jew. That is the most important thing I'll tell you tonight, because a lot of folks are off there. Now, Nebuchadnezzar's dream and the bear, the lion, and the leper, and that beast is fulfilled in the vision in Revelation 13, which I won't go there yet tonight, but I'll show that to you next week. My point is, here's where we're at. We went through all those empires up until the last one. That's going to be the revised Roman Empire. Remember, the 10 horns came from the Rome, and the 10 toes were, what were they? Iron and clay. So you know the iron is Rome, so it's a restoration of the Roman Empire. Boy, I'm saying a lot tonight. Are y'all with me? I'm trying to teach you something tonight. Stay with me. This is Bible. How many enjoy Bible study? I like it. Now, notice your chart. There's a gap between Messiah being cut off and the rapture. You said, what is that gap? It's the church age. The tribulation period is not for the church. It's for the Jew. When we study Daniel 9, it'll say it's for my people. And who is Christ's people? He came unto his own, and his own received him not. His people was the Jew, right? Now, let me close the next 15 minutes and ask you a question. Do you understand where you stand as in prophecy, what you believe, and why you believe it? Do you, if somebody come to you and asked you, Lois, or me, what are you? I will tell them this. I'm a premillennialist. But hold a minute. That's really not enough to tell them. Am I right? Because actually, Lois, there's 5 different groups of premillennialists. But only one's right. Now, stay with me. Look up at me. There is a new group out. I'm an independent fundamental Baptist, okay? Unapologetically. But there's a new group called the New IFB. That's it, New Independent Fundamental Baptist. Now, I will tell you where they differ from us. They differ in prophecy. They do not believe in the pre-tribulation rapture. Some of them are mid-tribulation raptures. A big part of them are pre-wrath people. Listen to this. Y'all with me? Another part of them don't even believe God's going to deal with the Jews again. They believe that the church fulfills the Jews. And God's done with the Jews. There's one guy, he's loco. I won't say his name. He's loco. I mean, El Fruitcake Dumbo. I mean, he really is. I mean, how many's ever studied the 144,000 in Revelation 7? What's it say? What's it say? Who's it say they are? It says there's 12,000 out of each tribe and names the tribes. But this crowd says, no, it's impossible because nobody knows those tribes. Well, let me say this to you. DNA tells us we can recognize three of them right now. However, it may be impossible for me to tell you who the 144,000 and who the 12 tribes is, but it's not me that's going to pick them out. It's God Almighty that's going to pick them out. Now, stay with me. Now, I talked about premillennialism. Let's learn some words. Brenda Perry, you here tonight? You remember when I got you down there at the Veterans Hospital and talked about the millennial and you asked the millennial reign? You said, what kind of reign? You remember? That's been 100 years ago, but you remember. Now, I believe in a millennial reign, but there are people that don't believe in the millennial reign. They believe, they're all millennialists. What's an all millennialist believe? They believe Revelation 20:1-6, where it talks about the 1,000-year reign 4 or 5 times there. They don't believe that's literal. They don't believe in a 1,000-year reign of Christ. They just don't believe it. And then there's another group called the postmillennial. Here's what they believe. Now, y'all still with me? They believe, now this is ridiculous, but here's what they believe. Everything, the church is going to make the world better, and the world's going to get better and better. And what we're doing right now, I don't know if y'all all know this, but we're in the millennial right now. And Satan's chained up. And they ain't no devil. And things are getting better and better until the world gets evangelized and Christ comes at the end of the millennial. I don't even eat Post Toasties because of that. But that's not the Bible. Amen? Now listen carefully. Stay with me. If I don't get done with this, will y'all come back next week so I can finish it and so you'll get it all? Because I really want to take my time. Now, did I say to you they were 5 groups that believe in some kind of millennial? But here's the problem. Out of the 5 groups, 4 of them believe it wrong. And only one group believes it right. And it's not the new independent Baptists. It's the old traditional independent Baptists who your pastor is one of. Amen. Right. Yes, sir. Now, let me explain them to you. And next week, Allison, we're going to print these timetables and give the group here so you can see it with your eyes. I don't literally have that tonight. But listen to me, and I'll explain it to you. Write this in your notes. Post-tribulation rapture. What is that? Now, here's what, and by the way, it's a false teaching. It teaches that church will remain on earth and go through the entire 7 years of the tribulation. And they teach there's no distinction between the rapture in the air and the revelation back on the ground. No distinction. And they teach that the church and Israel are synonymous. Ladies and gentlemen, the church and Israel are not synonymous. And Jesus Christ is going to fulfill every one of those covenants he made to Israel and to Abraham. And he's going to do it. And he'll do it during the tribulation and in the millennial kingdom. This crowd doesn't believe in a rapture. They don't believe it's intimate. The post-trib people, here's what they believe. They believe the 7 seals, the 7 trumpets, and the 7 bowls that you see in Revelation are concurrent. And also, of the 5 premillennial positions, this is the least literal. Now, I want to make a statement to you. Stop with me. If you believe that, Chad, you got to do away with all kinds of scripture. And here's how you do it, is by allegory and by symbolizing all the book of Revelation and saying that you can't take any of it literally. I want to ask, I'm going to tell you something now. If you don't study Bible as literal truth, you'll get off on your doctrine. Now, hold on a minute. You say, is there any symbols in the Bible? Look at me. Are there any symbols about? Yes, there is. But every symbol in the Bible is explained by Scripture. For example, oh boy, how many have ever heard this statement in Revelation, the seven spirits of God? How many's never heard of that? I'll be honest. Well, you're going to learn something tonight. Well, it's found in the Word of God in Revelation. But also is a fulfillment of prophecy in Isaiah 11. And it's talking about the complete power of the Holy Spirit of God. How did we understand that, Lois? We understood it by examining Scripture and seeing what those symbols meant, literally. Everybody with me? Don't y'all die on me. You said you're getting deep. I'm not trying to. I'm just trying to give you the truth. Now let's go to another crowd. Now this crowd and one other crowd is the two crowds that are trying. There are not a lot of these people, but they're the predominant enemies of pre-tribulation rapture today, and I'll give them to you. And that is a mid-tribulation rapture. How many of y'all know what a mid-tribulation rapture is? Here's what they believe. They believe the church goes through 3.5 years of the tribulation. Right? And then, that means we go through it. And then we're raptured in the middle of the tribulation. And then we miss the great tribulation. Am I right, Chad? Now, here's what they believe. They believe the seventh trumpet in Revelation 11 is synonymous with the last trumpet. When the trump shall sound and the dead will be raised at the rapture, they believe it's synonymous and that the two witnesses represent the church. Ladies and gentlemen, the two witnesses is a Moses and Elijah. Hello. Now, stay with me. We find that in Revelation 11 and 11:12, their thought. Now, why do they take the two witnesses as representing the church? Let me show you why. Because the dead in Christ will rise first, right? And those that alive and remain will be what? Jeremy, they'll be what? Raptured. Now, I got a real issue with this. First of all, that last trump is not going to be sounded. Those two witnesses don't go up when the trump blows. They go up before the trump blows. Just look at it tonight when you go home. Now, let me ask you something. How could they represent the church when both witnesses die? How could they represent the dead in Christ and the resurrected saints if both of them die? How many's with me right now? Y'all want to know why this preacher preaches like I do and teach like I do? Because there's a lot of false people out there leading people astray. And you know where they lead them astray at? In prophecy. How many remember, my time's almost up. I need an hour. That's how much time I need, but I want, yeah, let your heart not be troubled. I'll be done in 2 minutes. How many remember back in Guyana, South America, when Jim Jones took that group down there and they drunk a Kool-Aid and killed himself? Well, a lot of you weren't born then, but I was. You know why they done it? Because he said the world was going to end. And he talked about end times, and they were confused by end times. Ladies and gentlemen, the brightest Christian in this room is the Christian that is a discerner of the time. Well, I hate to cut it off now. No, I got to cut it off. Because there's some folks will flop on me here. Next week, can I mention this one and then we're done? Now, there's two more, and I'll cover this one when we come back next week. Do you know there's some people believe in a partial rapture? Oh, yes. They believe the Lord's going to come, pre-tribulation raptures, and take everybody in this room that's a good Christian out. The spiritual Christians get to go out. And you deadbeats. And you that didn't come to church today are going to be left behind. That's called partial rapture theory. And they believe only people that's looking for Jesus is going to go up. Now, I'll get back to this next week. But I want you to know that's wrong, and let me tell you why it's wrong. The Bible says when the Lord comes at the last trump, that everyone, all, is going to be translated. And he said that, preaching to the most carnal church of all, the church of Corinth. Ladies and gentlemen, you're not going up into rapture because you're a good Christian. You're going up to rapture because you're a child of God. And there's something in you. Oh, can I give you one more thing? Like they do on the five on every evening. One more thing. Let me give you an illustration out there, Jimmy. This is awesome. Listen to this, Jimmy. Imagine me having a handful of pins, metal pins, and a handful of wooden matches. And then I take a magnet, right? You with me? And I put that magnet over the wood and over the pins. Can I ask y'all a question? Which one's going to be lifted by the magnet? Oh, I'm staggering. You know what the magnet is? God. And you know what his nature is? The Holy Spirit. And he says, come up hither. And everybody that has that same nature, he's going to zap the magnet on them. And you know what's going to happen to you? You're going to lift up out of here and be raptured. Blink your eyes. Blink it. 11/100ths of a second. And you're from this world to the next world. But my question is, and I'm done, are you ready? Bow your head with me and I'm done. How many of you, not because of your church membership, not because of any religious affiliation, how many of you are 100% sure if you died tonight or Christ came tonight, you'd go to heaven? Raise your hand high. Hold it high. Thank you. Is there anybody here who couldn't raise your hand? All right. Let's stand. I'm going to dismiss. Everybody said to say. I hope you got something out of this. How many learned one thing tonight? Anything? Okay, that's good. Come back next week. You'll learn a lot more. Our Father, thank you for the good service, the Bible teaching. Oh, Lord, thank you for the truth you give me tonight. I was able to teach from the overflow. Help me again next week as I try to keep explaining all this so everybody will be plain to them, and help me teach on the other three views next week of the rapture. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Good night.